It's a fresh start. It's a brand new day. A day to live. A day to love. A day to laugh. It's Tuesday, December 11, Jamaica, 2012. It's Christmas time again. Good morning, listeners. I'm Clyde Williams. Welcome to Fresh Start.
Morning to you also. I'm Sharon Merle Hay Webster. And can I tell you how I know it's Christmas? I pass police officers' club and I see a piece of light in the middle of the field. The whole place light up.
Christmas!
So they have their own decorations there. It's wonderful to see all the lights going up
Festival
all over the place.
Lights.
Yes, yes. So, Clyde, you've done all your morning stretches and dance in the seat. Listeners,
yes.
You should see him every morning. He has this dance. This morning he was a little extra.
Yes, because some of the times you know that rhythm is sweet, isn't it?
Dun, yes, it is.
Dun,
yeah.
Run it again. Let's run it again a little bit for everybody. Hey, hey, that's right. Let's go. Up and down and round in town.
Wiggle the fingers and toes. All right. What's fresh for today,
Well,
Clyde?
You know, we just want to remind everybody we broadcast live from our studios here, Newstalk 93 FM at the University of the West Indies, and we stream Newstalk93FM.com. Hi, guys, on the internet on all over the world. We get calls, of course, you know, we get calls some occasionally from a little.
Yeah.
And text us during the course of the program, 899-7657. Sharon, is going to be a great program. Oh, wonderful program. We're going to look at the Middle East. Politics in the Middle East, and that's important to get a sense of what's happening. How does the Middle East impact on the rest of us? That's the place where not most big world religions came from: Christianity, Islam, Judaism.
Yes,
from the Middle East. And
significant religious movements have emanated from there.
So that's in counterpoint. We're going to look at the Middle East in the big picture. All right, in the big picture, it's going to be looking at flexi work.
Yeah, like us who get up at this time of the morning, 4 o'clock.
Flex now, well, you know, have you ever worked a midnight shift?
Yes.
Yeah, graveyard?
Yeah.
True?
Yes.
I'm not talking, you know, I'm talking.
No.
You have never worked, man.
All what? Right. Joke you're making, man. Behave yourself.
All right.
Well, we're going to be having discussions on the Flexi Work Week and its impact on Jamaica. That should be interesting.
Yes, and we're going to have one of those veteran politicians in Jamaica. He should have something to say.
Oh, yeah, that should be a very Pernell interesting
Charles
conversation with him.
So, hey, guys, you want to stick around for Pernell? I'm going to put some tough ones to him, so you stick around it. We're great
Why
friends.
Am I not surprised?
We're great friends, but you'll be fine with that. Well, you know, as we always say, every morning, it's important. Every morning, it's important just to kind of like, that's right, pause and give thanks. Let's have a little inspiration.
This morning, our inspirational readings are focused on time, and we have a partnered reading that looks at clear thinking is vital, which comes from A Manual for Living, a new interpretation by Sharon Liebel. Clear thinking is vital. The life of wisdom is a life of reason. It is important to learn how to think clearly. Clear thinking is not a haphazard enterprise. It requires proper training. It is through clear thinking that we are able to properly direct our will, stick with our true purpose, and discover the connections we have to others and the duties that follow from those relationships. Every person should learn how to identify mushy and fallacious thinking. Study how inferences are legitimately derived, so that you avoid drawing unfounded conclusions. For instance, note the following examples of faulty logic. I am richer than you, therefore I am better than you. One encounters such absurd assertions as this all the time, but they are completely fallacious. The valid inference that can be drawn is, I am richer than you, therefore I have more possessions or money than you do. Another example, I speak more persuasively than you, therefore I am better than you. From this we can only conclude, I speak more persuasively than you, therefore my speech carries more effect than yours. But remember, your character is independent of property, or persuasive speech. Take the time to assiduously study clear thinking and you won't be hoodwinked. Strong education in logic and the rules of effective argument will serve you well.
We take some readings from the Bible, Confucianism, and from a lady, Martha Trolley Curtin. The Bible. Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore, do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Ephesians 5, verses 15 through 17.
And our second reading comes from Confucianism. Very short. Study without reflection is a waste. Confucius.
And we close out our readings this morning. Time you enjoy wasting is not wasted time. Martha Trolley Curtin. You got it right. Time you enjoy wasting is not wasted time.
Can't be.
I came to say goodbye.
But why, Boris? Why?
I've made up my mind. I'm going away.
Then I shall be alone.
That journey into the desert you've spoken of, you will take it alone?
What else can I do?
Once you said to me that peace and happiness might be found there, you gave me hope. And now we have to say goodbye.
If you fall, I will catch you, time after time. Cyndi Lauper.
Even if it means a drop on my bottom toe, I will catch you.
Okay.
By some people. Well, let's go to the break and we'll come back with the State Morning Papers.
Talk 93 FM, broadcasting from the University of the West Indies, Mona Campus.
News Talk 93 FM, heard everywhere.
Welcome back to Fresh Start from News Talk 93 FM from the University of the West in his big station. And of course, we stream live newstalk93fm.com. Good morning again, friends. I have some friends, you know, they're faithful friends. I need to say especially good morning. Thank you very much. It's a blessing and honor for you to listen on me and for all listeners. It's
okay, you got your honor. Personal phantom, yeah, honey.
No,
okay.
I'm just saying that you didn't say Clyde. So all my friends, I tell you what, it's Clyde Williams 46. That's how you get me on Twitter. So it's Clyde Williams 46. We're gonna build that out some more. All right, what do we have in the papers?
I want to take
Reggae
your
Sharon. What
on Twitter. No. Then go ahead then and tell them no.
I think it's Reggae Sharon.
Right.
That's right. It's selection. All right.
Samuel Slaughter, I pick up from you when I go to the sports page because I know you would love that, right?
And alongside
Samuel
that,
Slaughter, batsman's 85 off 43 balls leads West Indies to tour-ending win. Fabulous.
Jeez. Mm-hmm. And alongside that, on the front page of the Gleaner, more sports. Axeman to get keys to the city.
Yeah, second city, second capital, Mobe.
To honor new boxing champ.
Good.
Newly minted World Boxing Association featherweight boxing champion Nicholas Axeman Walters is in line to receive the keys to the city of Montego Bay following his historic win over Colombian Dolis Prescott on Saturday night in Kingston. Walters knocked out Prescott 35 seconds into the seventh round after twice flooring him in earlier rounds to become the first Jamaica to win a boxing
World Boxing
at home soil.
Right.
Man, let me tell you, I got goose pimples.
You watched? Okay.
No, I didn't watch it. When I heard about it, I didn't get a chance. But when I heard about it, I just got goose pimples. He had promised that he was going to deliver.
Right.
And he did.
And the true sportsman deliver. That you are, you appreciated it.
Can I tell you, we punch above. Remember, we have had a line of champions, you know, boxing champions, you know.
Before,
if, yes. Yeah. Even if they didn't stay here on the left.
Mike McCallum.
Yes. Oh, you mean the body snatcher?
Yeah, man.
What else is on the
snatching. Expensive and unsafe, which is the headline. Government hunts consultants to consider feasibility of rural school bus system. Despite calling for proposals to develop a rural school bus system, strategy and implementation plan, Transport Works and Housing Minister Dr. Omar Davis said there is no guarantee such a system will come on stream. Quoting him, there is a commitment in policy to have a system for rural students, but we don't have any data on the size of the problem, Davis told the Gleaner. He added, some places have nothing, some places have an existing system, but we have no data on the size, so that's what the request is supposed to do, is to put us in a position to have some data. And it goes on. In September, Prime Minister Portia Simpson Miller said in Parliament that Education Minister Ronald Thwaites and Davis had been tasked, to consider the possibility of a national school bus system. She cited huge expenses borne by rural students, as well as safety concerns, as compelling reasons to establish such a system.
Very important.
It is.
I mean, the question of the affordability, I imagine, is going to loom large.
Yeah, we remember the examples that we see Marissa Dalrymple, Filbert's picture and Omar's picture here, and she had given the examples of children who had to travel from, for example, Troy and Alberttown to get into Spalding, and what the cost would be, and that even from her CDF, it would be impossible for her to support fares for all of the requests that came to her, and it was really something that needed to be done, because taxis chasing up and down to transport these kids put them at risk, eh?
Yes, I mean, that goes without saying, and wow, we, you know, so the question is going to be for us, it can't just be, because affordability cannot just be market. Meaning that there must be other things that we put in the equation, because it's not fair for those children by virtue of being in rural Jamaica. They have placed, but even Kingston children have to get it from like before day.
Paddy, can I tell you something? This morning I was taken aback. I saw a young lady in her Arden uniform walking past Jamaica House that is going down to make a turn to Arden Road. This is 20 to 6. Clyde, what should we be in at school so early?
All right, some other items in the news on page two of the Gleaner. I should not be living like this. Disabled mother needs a house or a family. And it's a story about a struggling Jamaican mother struggling through a really hard life since the day she was born. 28-year-old earner Denise Cheetah has a strong, determined spirit that causes her never to give up. And that's a story about that family on page one. Over on page two.
Page two. You mean over on page three.
Yeah. Sorry, page three. What do we have there, Sharon?
Gold Hunt On. Mining company to get exclusive prospecting license for precious metals. Is this in Clarendon? Let me see. A new player is getting ready to hit the ground, running in a quest to unearth in Jamaica an increasingly expensive metal on the international marketplace. Despite less than favorable results to date by many companies which carried out exploratory work locally to find a precious metal, Rio Minerals Jamaica Limited yesterday signaled that it is in the process of getting a special exclusive prospecting license to dig for gold.
All right, they're gold diggers, aren't they?
Well, we had seen stuff come about this before, as you say, December 2002. It's Pennons. That's what I thought. It was up in the hills of Clarendon.
Mine some gold. Also on that page, very important news for if Jamaicans. We will recall the American Airlines crash some long time ago.
Yes.
So American Airlines pays millions to Kingston crash victims. American Airlines AA has reportedly paid out millions of dollars in damages to several persons who were injured when one of its aircraft crashed in Kingston almost 3 years ago. At the same time, the Jamaican law firm of Wilson Franklin and Barnes, which secured the settlement, said it is still in negotiations with the U.S. carrier on behalf of other victims of the crash. However, Delana Franklin, a senior partner in the law firm, yesterday declined to divulge details of the case, saying he wanted to, quote, trod carefully because the process is ongoing.
And we know that there were somewhat 145 passengers that narrowly escaped death in December 2009, when AA Flight 331 flying from Miami to Kingston overshot the runway and came to stop inches from the sea just off Port Royal Main Road. We say, Father God, thank you.
We never forget that.
No, I don't forget that.
Too many squatters. Also an item in the news, rusted zinc fences, board houses constructed in a haphazard manner, limited land space and little or no sanitary conveniences paint a bleak picture of the many informal settlements dotted across Jamaica.
And we looked at there's a little yellow blurb in there, detached by parishes, data on the number of detached units situated on land illegally by parishes, Kingston 634, St. Andrew 5,827.
You want to just let's have a look at that later in as we look at the papers, and as I see it, you probably could speak a little bit more about spotting problem.
Page A5, some sexy pictures here. Purple here.
Yeah.
Okay. Bitch, I'm sorry, on the social page. Trust me, I see some steps being dropped at the Sagi Court.
Fashionista. That's
Fashionista. Right. Tazai Knuckle is ready for her ringside seat inside the VIP lounge at the National Indoor Sports Center Saturday for the Rumble on Jamrock Night of Boxing.
What?
A blondie and a red brunette and a purple.
But the big man himself. Listeners, you gotta have a look at paper three. Something extra social.
A5.
In the Gleaner.
Right.
You gotta have a look at it. All right. So we turn around quickly. The Gleaner's editorial focuses on set up regional councils instead. In the event you didn't work out what it was, that booming sound at the weekend was the chest thumping captured by this newspaper of the five parish council chairmen in the county of Cornwall, and they go on. We have achieved quite a lot, and we are quite pleased with the work being done, said Mr. Moore, or the performance of his council, but summing up the sentiment of his colleagues in other parishes. Local government reform, a waste of time. Regional councils, Gleaner is urging on us. That's been around for a long time.
Yes, true. Well, this article by Maurice Tomlinson taking on Shirley Richards from the Lawyers Christian Fellowship discussing the issue of rights charter. Interesting.
Right.
Should have a look at that one.
A tragic case of ignorance, he says.
Yes.
These are matters that have occupied the minds of centuries of people, millions of people for centuries. So, Fruitgasm. That's on the Glean Entertainment page. You want to
okay,
read it?
Okay, blends food, art, and entertainment.
Let me see the Observer while you look at that.
Here. Have a fun. No, but can I tell you, listeners, you know what I'm laughing at? There's this huge melon here, and it's carved with the Gleaner insignia on it. And it's beautiful work that's done, eh? Really nice work. It says, Geron South presents a carved watermelon to QP during the latter's video shoot. So entrepreneur Geron South is aiming to break new ground on the local entertainment scene by merging food, entertainment, and art through his company, Fruitgasm.
That's right.
According to the artist who developed food carving skills online, culinary art has its place in the entertainment industry. Yeah.
All right, we turn to the
What's
Observer.
What's in the Observer today?
We just have one, so we kind of like squeeze around with it. And so
squeeze
on with
around.
All right, let's start that day. Sports
again. Playing this morning.
Sports again. Well done photograph on the back of the Observer with the captain of the West Indies team, Darren Sammy, shaking the hands of his teammate, Marlon Samuels, after the T20 match against Bangladesh, where we won by 18 runs. Wonderful, wonderful.
But you know, I watched Australia, the semifinals. It was interesting seeing...
Of the World
Yes,
20.
Yemen. Mm-hmm. And it was something else watching West Indies pin down Australia, you know.
Yes.
It was very interesting.
Are you uninitiated?
No, dear. It was, but I was just saying, it was.
You seem to be a little uninitiated.
Go away.
Boys in Trouble, also in the, on the sports
Give
page.
Give me the middle of the paper,
of the,
man.
Of the Observer.
Since you're giving trouble, let me take our next piece. Come.
All right, there you go.
Uh-oh,
Caribbean
and guess which
champions.
One I get. Observer team.
That's all right.
I catch my H paper.
Caribbean Cup champions face exit after 0-0 draw. A horrible performance so far by the boys in the Caribbean Cup in Antigua. Can you imagine not making it to the knockout round of the Caribbean Cup where we're defending champions? Come on, boys.
Ooh.
Gotta play something for you today.
Yeah.
Oh,
well,
goodness.
Teen tips what to do this Christmas. Spend time with the family. Visit the Gramps. Who else can make the best ham and Christmas cake? Only grandma, don't it? Have a fancy outing, get a Christmas job, spend a little time reviewing schoolwork, and volunteer or visit a home. In other
Christmas
words, share.
A goat for me, and a goat me grow up on.
Goat?
Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, Clarendon, you come from,
yeah,
that's why.
We're not deep on the holy part. Well, my little family, never deep on over pork tea.
Oh, well, are the pork you fight?
Fight?
Look here, that's
pork.
One of the biggest markets for us.
So we're really having Christmas.
You have Christmas ham too, you know, which is chicken ham, my friend.
Sorry, lad, Christmas time.
Yes.
With a little rum in it and a nice.
A little?
And a, yes, and so forth. So, listeners, it's Christmas again. No matter what we do, just rest and have a good time with friends and family.
And
tourism
Christmas is
rebounds.
Tourism time, right?
Tourism rebounds.
There are about
the front page
five
of
stories
the
inside the Observer on tourism today.
Of
yeah.
The Daily Observer, tourism rebounds. Winter season looking good for Jamaica. Jamaica's tourism sector has grown by 2.4% so far this year over the same period last year, despite a sluggish start and the negative effects of Hurricane Sandy and the presidential election in the United States. This was revealed by Tourism Minister Dr. Wickham McNeil, who said Jamaica recorded 100,000 visitor arrivals in the month of September for the first time in its history. And that continues on page 4 with that. Sharon, if we could only find a way to really have the synergies between tourism, culture, entertainment, and sports.
Yes.
To really have some synergies around that and some calendar events on the entertainment scene. We have some.
You mean other than Sunsplash and Rebel Salute and that kind of thing?
We have some emerging. We have some over in Negril in the summertime.
Yes.
When there are two investors largely who are down in Negril for a week, and the boost that they get locally and of course entertainers, there's a lot more we can do to kind of just pull all of those things together. And our food and cuisine.
Well, given that, and see, we just had a thing from fruit gasm. But I'm just saying though, given that we're in the tourist season now, we'll have a chance in our program to be able to explore some more of those options with some of the top players within the sector and also those on the edge who want to come in. So let's have an opportunity to explore that some more, eh?
I love this story.
Historic Moscow to Mobe flight fully booked. The historic first flight from Moscow, Russia to Montego Bay in January next year is said to be fully sold out, according to Jamaica's Tourism Minister, Dr. Wickham McNeil. Russian airline Transaero will begin non-stop service from Moscow to Montego Bay on January 1st using a Boeing 777-777 aircraft with a seating capacity of 300 passengers. The flight is scheduled to arrive at 1 p.m., McNeil told the Jamaica Observer Monday Exchange at the newspaper's head offices in Kingston yesterday. The chartered flight, organized by Russian tour operator Biblia Globus, is scheduled to operate initially for 3 months, with discussions for them to continue into the summer and throughout the entire year. That's good news.
Well, you know, people, the pathways built in the 1970s seem to be kind of benefiting us a little bit. I'm not making, I'm just saying, because that's all.
Let me leave your room. Go. You want it, man.
For instance.
I'm teasing about, yes, it's true.
For instance, the pathways we built between Cuba and ourselves at the time when it was not popular, surely will serve us well in the future going forward as Cuba is opened up a little bit, as it liberalizes and so on. We need to make sure we continue to build those pathways between ourselves.
Well, we've seen tourism also, because some of our Jamaican investors have gone to Cuba.
Absolutely.
To invest in property there, and that certainly is a precursor, it would seem, as for when their boundaries open up even further, that they're within the global marketplace better in respect of hopefully that these sanctions from the US will be cut in our lifetime, Clyde.
Oh, goodness gracious me.
And
boy,
we see then, but you know, it's a discussion that will be ongoing, because many persons have expressed the view that once Cuba opens up, then boy, we are behind the eight ball.
That's persons who don't understand it.
They're, well, this is why I said we need to have more discussion on it and get rid of that. It's a fear factor, you know.
What we need to do is to have those pathways. We have Brand Jamaica, build it.
Yes.
JUTC seeking fair hike.
Ouch.
The Jamaica Urban Transit Company, JUTC, is in the process of seeking a fare increase, likely to come into effect by next April. The JUTC has projected that for 2012-13 budget, its loss before subsidy would increase to over $2.4 billion. Wow, gotta have that sorted out. Church leaders to stage march in Mobe on Saturday. A group of Christian leaders in Montego Bay staging a march and motorcade in that resort city this Saturday in an effort to change attitudes and behavior in the country. We're desperately trying to bring change to both our city and nation. I don't mind the march, but that's not going to change any attitudes.
But funny enough, there are stories there on the church to look at the battered wife issue and a handout ceremony for the Salvation Army that went awry. It's a pity that happened. So you have to manage when you put situations, when you put people in situations for handouts, you really have to be so careful in how you manage handouts, you know, because people can get ridiculous, if it might seem.
Let's go to the break, and when we come back, we have a look at an issue or two. Welcome back to Fresh Start. I hope we have got you off to a fresh start. So it's breakfast time for many people now. I think people are hustling around and so on. Oh, I'm so hungry. Can I get some fruits? Can somebody please?
I want some porridge.
Yeah, I want porridge. Bring me a bowl of fruits. Oh. Marriage immediately, one, you know. All right, listeners. Well, there are a couple of issues that have come out at us in the papers today. I want to have a look at the editorial from the Gleaner. The Gleaner's editorial focuses on overhauling the local government system in the country. So text us 8997657. 8997657. Set up regional councils instead. So let's just take a little bit from this at the end. They discuss the whole system and they make the case at the end. Which brings us to our fundamental issue, the viability and usefulness of the local government authorities as they and the wider system of local government are currently structured. In that regard, it is a firm view that two decades of the so-called local government reform has largely been a monumental waste of time. It has largely been about inconsequential nibblings at the margins. Our position, therefore, is to either dump the parish councils and flatten out the system of government, or radically overhaul them into viable institutions capable of delivering services to their constituents. We propose a revisiting of the plan of Arnold Bertram, then Minister of Local Government, placed on the table a decade ago, collapsing the existing councils into larger regional bodies, which hopefully will create economies of scale and a greater concentration of management talent. For instance, the councils of the five aforementioned and I spoke about in Cornwall would be bundled into a single large council, giving it greater financial viability and the ability to recruit skilled employees whose pay would be linked to performance. The KSAC and the St. Thomas and St. Catherine Parish Councils might be made into one, with the other six pulled into suitable configurations. The bottom line is that parish councils, as now structured, offer little.
Well, we've seen that there has been some attempt to change the impact already in respect of the Portmore municipality, in respect of responding to local initiative.
Nibbling
but we
edges.
Haven't, yes, I was about to say that, because even now there are still two seats within the Portmore Council. Where the councillors
can't. Let's take it forward. Let's take on head on.
Gleaner yes, that's says, what I'm going.
Gleaner says.
Yes.
Gleaner says, hey, 20 years we've been having this so-called reform. The system is not working.
You mean discussing the reform? How much?
Yes, discussing.
Although we have seen some
edges,
of them, because
yes.
technical people, like there are no planners,
yes,
no
edges.
Trained planners,
yes,
hired and on staff of all of the parish councils. That wasn't there before. Because
right.
before, everybody had to come to town planning department to
edges,
get the approval.
Edges.
Right? That makes some difference in terms of approvals
so
on the ground. Right.
Let's go regional so we
yes.
get economies of scale. Let's go regional so we can use our scarce resources to hire expertise in technical expertise in the five regions, administrative, including accounting expertise in the regions. So rather than try to have a reproduction of an efficient staff in all 15 of them as we have now, let's concentrate so we can then pay for quality for staff at a higher level. And so the delivery of services, because these bodies really ought to be engaged in the delivery of services and
to the community. Which services are these now? These are, for example, the bar and licensing,
those kinds
the
of
hairdressing and so on. Many people don't make a link with these licensing services
right.
that provide us with connectivity.
Regulators, you
on
call
the
it.
Right, on
right.
the ground in our communities,
right.
even in terms of our shops.
Public health,
yes.
Markets, and a variety of other things, and motor vehicle registration. And, well, not necessarily
local
that,
roads,
local roads, and so on. But the point is,
parking areas.
There you go. The point is,
taxi services, transport.
It's not been done efficiently, and the school bus system that we're speaking about. We could easily configure it around regions.
The regional
also,
planning, yes.
And so forth and so on. Carl Stone wrote about this from his own research many years in the 1980s, and he had proposed four regional administrative bodies, he called them four. The Bertram study had said five, but the number is something we can work through.
Right, it's
Stone,
the concept that we're endorsing.
Right. Stone had in fact twinned urban St. Catherine with Kingston because
which
of
I think is a better deal than St.
And,
Thomas.
And the relationship.
I don't agree with putting St. Thomas into KSAC.
I don't remember what you have done with St. Thomas. I just remember that specifically.
It's better you keep St. Mary, Portland, St. Thomas together as a northeast region because naturally those communities relate to each other more.
He had, along those lines, I must search for his work on that. And so it was also felt that it would de-partisan politicize the way councils would operate because they would become significant administrative bodies to administer in the regions, and so the thing would shift a little bit. The real question for us as a people is, if we accept that there have been failures in the existing local government system to deliver governance and services, why not let's just take a pause as part of our look at our overall system of government and change. We've been talking about it too long. We need to sign off at some end game, say, well, by that time we want to sign off and take decisions.
Part of it though too, you see, Clyde, is that you have to build out the capabilities of the local communities to fit into those models too. And why do I say that? We speak about the system of local governance without understanding to that if at the local level there is not selected leadership, as in communities. Stimulated. No, citizens association, youth clubs, senior citizens groups, because how will that regional assembly, so to speak, link back to the community?
But
we speak about the impact of local governance and the gaps.
The same
and
way.
Part of the gap, let me just tell you from my own experience, part of the gap is because there's not organization on the ground that the parish leadership, or as we would say now, the regional leadership, can relate to.
I don't know if I agree with that.
Well, how do you test the capabilities? This is where joined up governance comes in, because you must get the link between the local social organizational building service, such as your SDC and NIS, right? Which builds out your development area committees and your parish development committees. But the same committees really have been...
I have a different...
approach?
Yeah,
tell me.
This is just a view I have. I think we can't top-down community associations. We can't top-down say that we need them. Let me tell you how I honestly feel about the whole situation. I grew up with very strong association of citizens. Even if they're small, very strong in Portmore and in other areas of the country.
But look at the difference that made in Portmore.
Right? Very strong. Even if they're small, very strong.
Yes.
And not partisan. And what I found is the extent to which political parties seek to co-opt the leadership of these local organizations is the extent to which these organizations are weakened. That is,
I wasn't approaching it from that perspective,
But I'm just saying to you that part of the problem that, I'm not saying I'm correct, this is an opinion, providing an analysis. My own view is that when I look at how Jamaica had a lot more voluntary organizations active in communities and in the wider country, that people have to be struggling for space now because parties tend to crowd out the power space in terms of wanting to share it between themselves, the power space. So,
Give me an example. Give me something that... I hear your argument, but I'm not feeling it. Give me an example.
Let me give a simple example.
Yeah.
Usually when plans are being designed for a constituency, the typical approach is that it is driven by the party and the party grouping in that constituency. If you are the MP, your primary base of consultation, typically, and interaction is your party base.
Not necessarily.
No, I didn't say, I'm saying, but that is your primary. That's the people
Factually,
that's the people you interact with. That's the people you account to on the ground because typically that's
You can't get proper development if you do that, because there's a limit.
But that's why we don't
have it. No, but there's a limit to it. But I would say to you that within communities where I've had the opportunity to build out. Yeah, but we're talking about practice now.
Yes, yes.
Right? And let's look at
so
Central
you
Village.
The dominant practice. I want to know if this is what you're saying. You say the dominant practice in Jamaica is for the MPs, and listeners, you can text us. It's for the MPs to interact on a structured, normative manner with a cross-section of community associations.
You don't get a benefit if you don't. If you do otherwise, if you sit and only work within your political structure to drive that.
I didn't say work alone in your political
structure. No, but you're saying primarily.
Yes.
And if primarily you do that, then you get imprisoned by that.
Right.
So you pick up nothing else.
So
and as a result, you get that gap.
Right.
Right?
Which
so
is
this
what we
is
have.
Why.
So what,
you,
I'm saying,
yeah, but what I'm
on.
What I'm showing you though
yeah.
is that when you work outside of that, for example, look at the Central Village Business Watch District, where Las Chin is the chairman
Sharon,
there.
Sharon, I'm generalizing and looking at normative positions. What you just described to me is exactly what happens in Jamaica. Most of us are disconnected from the system because the political parties behave like little exclusive clubs, and when they become MP, the primary consultation and so on is with their members. That's what happens. So guess what?
Well, I was just showing you that I didn't, and it made a difference.
No, but I wasn't talking about you. I was just saying that...
But there are many others like myself.
Wow, I haven't seen a lot of them, though. Let's go to the break. When we come back from the break, it'll be time for...
Snippets.
Snip, snip. Da-da.
Enjoy it.
A funny story, a queer story, a weird story,
a shocking story,
a shocking story, a laughable story, whatever. It's time for snippets.
Crazy stuff. So what's on the snipping agenda today?
24 karat gold pills that make you poop gold.
What? Now why do I want to pay to do that?
Well, you don't want to poop?
Yeah.
Gold?
No.
That's why you do it. You take the pills to poop gold.
All right. Well, I guess you have lack of discretionary income.
Yes. Created back in 2005. You can wash them off at the end. Created back in 2005 by late New York artist Toby Wong in collaboration with Ken Courtney. These swallowable 24G gold pills are said to turn your innermost parts into chambers of wealth.
Whoa, really?
Well, you know, poop can turn fertilizer. Gold pills were originally launched by Wong and Courtney.
Gold fertilizer,
Can I tell you? Remember this. We say that every morning we need a little dose of laughter. Sometimes a little silly. Right?
Yeah, this is crazy.
Okay. Wong and Courtney, as part of their Indulgence Line, an art project that commenced on society's ever-expanding market of luxury items. But in the last 7 years, they have become quite a hit with luxury addicts.
Mm.
And their price has skyrocketed to $425. All poor people in Jamaica would have run it down now because that's how we steer. We love it.
Boy,
we can't afford it, but we see the bling and want it.
All
poor,
right.
Poor, rich, and middle.
Okay.
That's probably just chump change for rich kids looking for new ideas to take their already decadent lifestyles to new heights. So it's no wonder Citizens to Citizen, the web store selling the pills, states that they are, quote, temporarily unavailable.
Yeah, that sounds like setting up a drive for it.
It's not clear if for the above-mentioned price you get one or two or three gold pills.
Wholesale.
But I bet some of the people who bought them actually swallowed them to see if it makes their poop glitter. All that glitters is not gold.
Oh, excuse me. All right.
All right, snipping along, snip, snip.
A baby crying festival held in Japan.
Mm-hmm.
No mother likes it when her toddler starts crying. But at the Naki Sumo Baby Crying Contest, wailing is actually encouraged. Held every year at the Sensoji Temple in Tokyo. The Baby Crying Festival is a 400-year-old tradition, though, laughter.
Four centuries.
400 years old. So, and it is believed to keep rugrats in good health. Amateur sumo wrestlers. Sumo wrestlers, we should tell our listeners, are...
For those
big,
who don't know.
Fluffy. Let's just say big gentlemen, really big. They got rolls of tummy.
All right, you call it tires.
Tires,
that's
and they
right.
wrestle, right? Okay. And they don't look very handsome.
Them trang do, go on.
I'm telling you. So, amateur sumo wrestlers hold the babies high in the air and try to scare them into crying. While a sumo referee judges the match, The toddler who cries the longest and loudest is considered the winner.
But that just so...
Japanese parents bring to the contest of their own free will and truly believe that the suma-induced crying keeps their children in good health. I guess it, you know...
Oxygen.
And muscles. And it wards off evil spirits, Clyde. This year, 80 babies, all under 1 year old, participated in Naki Sumo. As you might have guessed, the whiniest contender won.
All right. Here's what.
Look at the faces of these children crying. Oh,
God.
Oh,
I don't know. You scared the child into crying?
Yes.
All right. Culture is culture, but it just seems a little...
No, I'm trying to decide, are they crying because they're looking at the sumo? At each other and they say, oh no, I can't stand this, take me away.
Snip, snip.
Whoops.
Snipping along. The world's youngest tattoo artist, 3-year-old Ruby Dickinson from Wales, is preparing to ink a small tattoo on her father's body and become the youngest tattoo artist on Earth.
Okay.
Ruby has been living in a tattoo-filled environment ever since she was born. Her father, Blaine, has his own tattoo shop set up right in their home.
Hmm.
The tattooing has already become part of Ruby's life, and she always talks to her father's customers about what they're planning to ink on their bodies and repeats whatever her father tells them on the matter.
Because she's part of the customer service.
There
like.
You go.
Mm.
Blaine has already ordered a special tattooing tool from the States, one that fits Ruby's small hands. Right now, she's practicing her favorite design, a spider, about the size of a 2p coin. Since a 1 cent that.
Mm.
We don't have a
That's
one
really
cent.
Smart. Yeah, we still have 1 cent.
True, yeah, 25 cents. You know, but I can't go to win a Jamaica. People,
red money, yeah. So we don't want the red money.
No.
True.
See, can I tell you, people, we're too out of order. We're out of order. We don't understand the thing. You can't have $1 million if you have 25 cents less. So we can go on with the foolishness.
Okay, true.
Young lad,
true,
make
true.
We know. We need to treat money differently in a work. So. You can't have $1 million if you have dollar less. So you need to and $1 million start with $1. 1 cent, in fact.
Yes.
Blaine has already ordered, yes, you read that. Since her father already has 70% of his body covered
70%.
With tattoos, he's not worried Ruby might mess up the spider. Brent says, this will set her off on a fantastic career.
Whoa.
And a tattoo machine is a lot cheaper than university fees.
Look here, in a man. That rationale, please. Please. A tattoo machine is a lot cheaper than university fees. True. So you're limiting her to just tattooing for life?
He's a worthless.
Okay.
Oh, that sounds so worthless. Snipping along.
Well, this one is not worthless. Indians write the longest letter to God.
Snip, snip.
A group of students from an Indian university celebrated their silver jubilee year by setting a new world record for the longest letter. The Brahma, look here now, I usually can get these, Brahma Kumaris, right, youth wing of Gujarat University, found an original way to celebrate their silver jubilee year, the university's diamond jubilee year, and 600 years since the establishment of Ahmedabad city. They decided to organize an event where people could write their own letter to God. In just 3 hours' time, 2,800 people wrote down their feelings of gratitude for their happy lives and also asked for the removal of poverty, protection from terrorism, corruption, and other evils. The letter ended up being 2,841 feet long. Participants were grateful. That's a very long piece of paper.
So how do you
or
get
cloth,
to God?
Whatever.
How is it delivered to God? No, I'm asking.
I don't know.
I just Clyde. Want to know.
I don't know, Clyde. Let's see.
You
Let me finish the story.
The send button because it's not an email.
So, you can't scan it.
But how does it get to God?
I don't know. Somebody need to create a site because everything is a matter of ideas. Okay? So we create the idea of a God site.
Right.
And then scan the letter,
yeah.
All 2,841 feet of it, and send it off.
All
does
right.
that answer you?
Yes.
Okay, good. Participants were grateful for such an occasion to thank God for everything he helped them achieve in life. Organizers say this kind of event is perfect for people who want to learn how to write letters to God. Okay. The previous record for the world's longest letter was established by 2,000 of Romanian countrymen who wrote a 1,358-foot-long letter for Santa Claus. Now, I want to know, how did they get that one to Santa Claus, Clyde?
Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer.
Oh, all right, you just hook it on and him sleigh and him just gone with it. All right.
I don't even know those songs. All right,
snip. Then how you come to it little while and you don't know it. You
I
see it?
I know the first line, Rudolph the Red-Nosed Reindeer. That's all I know.
Had a bright and shiny nose, something like that.
Oh, yes.
Right.
When
there?
They saw him...
Stop it.
Snipping right along. All right, listeners. It's time for the OMG of the day.
A hot one. It's called the Atomic Fallout Burger. So hot, you need gloves to eat it. All right, let me go on. Living up to its name, the Atomic Fallout Burger is so hot that owners the Atomic Burger restaurant in Bristol, England, require daredevils to sign a waiver council and wear protective gloves so not to burn their hands.
Can I tell you this? I love the British. I love the English.
Well, look, them have scotch bonnet pepper in it too.
Hang on. Diplomacy and hooligans. Football hooligans?
Yes, true.
And
very
some
true.
Of the greatest diplomats. I love the British.
Stiff upper lip. Eating a burger is usually a pleasurable experience, but chowing down on the Atomic Fallout Burger is a painful challenge. According to restaurant owner Martin Bunce, the sauce in the mouth-burning fast food treat contains, quote, a variety of chilies, including the ghost chili and the scotch bonnet. Oh, I wonder if it comes from Jamaica.
I don't know.
Especially the purple one. But what gives the sauce a real kick is the ghost chili extract. What is that? Duppy? Duppy pepper? Okay. And...
which registers at 4.2 million Scoville units.
Now, what are Scoville units, Council? Burn units.
A unit of when... Have you ever had curry that was peppered?
Yes.
And what happens on the next day?
Uh-oh, no. Oh,
Burn units.
All right.
You can understand why some people are referring to the Atomic Fallout as the hottest burger in the world. Apart from the stomach-melting ghost chili extract, chefs at the Atomic Burger in Bristol use also a variety of other chilies, including the tiny... but ultra hot scotch bonnet.
Why them never say flavor to scotch bonnet? Have no flavor to, you know.
Oh, jeez. Can I tell you?
Not just hot.
The follow challenge, where patrons are asked to chow down on the $25 hot burger.
£25 party. Oh. £25. Pay £25 for a burger?
Under an hour was introduced as a 4-week special at the Bristol restaurant. Sir, can I tell you this? Challengers have to go through 18 ounces of minced beef and 18 ounces of cheese sandwiched between two deep-fried pizza slices instead of buns, as well as a triple serving of chili fries.
Aye.
Mr. Bunce says that about 500 people have so... Whew, that's hot. All right, listeners, that's all we have for snippets today. We go to the news, and after the news, we will continue with today's program. Come back with us for Counterpoint at 7:15. We are traveling. All right, listeners, we are going to the Middle East to have a look at what's happening there in politics and society in general. So we thought we'd just give a little clip, not too long, to identify the space we're going to be in. You're in Counterpoint. I'm Clyde Williams. It's First Start.
And I'm Sharon Merle Hay Webster. And in Counterpoint discussion this morning, we're having discussions with Professor Muhammad Mushli of Long Island University. Dr. Mushli is an associate professor of political science at the Long Island University. His areas of research interests include the Middle East, intellectual thought, political change, the Arab-Israeli conflict, and U.S. policy towards the Middle East. In 1988, his book, The Origins of Palestinian Nationalism, was released by Columbia University Press. His most recent book, The Origins of Arab Nationalism, was published in 1993, also by Columbia University Press. Good morning, Professor Mushley.
Good morning.
How are you?
I am fine, thank you.
Yes, wonderful. I hope it's not too cold there in New York.
No, it's moderately cold.
Okay, good.
Well, we'll send a little more Jamaican warmth to warm you up a little more.
Are you on the air or not yet?
Professor Mushley, can you just help us to understand first, when we speak about Middle East, what countries are we talking about?
Okay, you have the Arab countries, you have Israel, you have Turkey, you have Iran, and you have North Africa. That is Libya, Morocco, and Tunisia.
I noticed some...
And
yes.
During the Bush administration, they tried to expand the Middle East. They talked about the larger Middle East and added to it parts of the Indian subcontinent.
Can I ask you one thing, though, from that grouping you have given us, though, Professor? Turkey, is Turkey not part of the EU also?
Not yet.
Not
Turkey has applied a long time ago for membership in the European Union, and they keep procrastinating. I think that there are two reasons for the European procrastination. One reason has to do with the demographic factor. The majority of the Turkish population is younger in age, while the population of many European countries is aging. So there is concern about the economic impact of having Turkey becoming a member in the European Union. The other factor has to do with religion, I think. It is because Turkey is an Islamic country. Turkey is governed today by a moderate, Western-oriented political party. I think it is one has to wait a long time for the European Union to really integrate or absorb Turkey in its union.
Professor Mushley.
By the way, European Union is not really a union.
Yes.
it doesn't have a general foreign policy. Each country has its own orientation as far as foreign policy is concerned. It is more an economic union than a political union.
Professor Mushley, the Middle East, these countries you referred to a while ago, at what point in the development of man did they become known as Middle East, and who named and why?
Could you repeat the question? We're having a problem with the line.
I'm sorry. The countries you referred to earlier when you were itemizing the Middle East country, when did they first become known as a group and called Middle East, and who gave them that name?
As you know, much of that region was colonized by the British and the French. The borders that we have today in the Arab East, for example, Syria, Jordan, Lebanon, Iraq, are really the result of arbitrary drawing of borders for these countries. Egypt has been there for thousands of years, and it has become really independent after the Suez tripartite war against it in 1956. As for the Gulf States, they have recently become independent about 40, 50 years ago, with the exception of Saudi Arabia. But the other oil-rich states became independent only in the late 1960s.
In the
Algeria, for example,
yes,
became independent in the early 1960s. It was under French colonialism. Libya was under Italian colonialism. And borders of most of these countries were drawn by Western imperial powers, mainly the British and the French.
I notice that a lot of the flags have the following colors. A lot of them have red and green. White and black are also dominant colors in several of them. Is there any particular reason that you know of, or information that could assist us as to why, if there is, the countries have flags have red and green as predominant colors and white and black as other colors too?
Green is the symbol of Islam, and red is a symbol of resistance to foreign domination.
I see.
You know what I find interesting in your comments in respect of the colonizers, though, Professor? They are British and French, as you point out, but the language of the colonizers has not stayed as part of the main language of the states that you now describe, or that we acknowledge as the Middle East. How have they been able to keep language separate and have their own distinct culture stay, even within the boundaries as set as the from the colonizers?
It is precisely because the peoples of that region were fiercely independent, and they resisted Western attempts to impose their culture or their way of life on them. And language, Arabic language, is a pillar of Arab identity. Every Arab believes that by virtue of his of speaking Arabic, he belongs to a larger Arab entity or nation. This is in theory, at least. This is one reason. The other reason was the pride in the Arabic language. Every Arab is proud of the language because it is the Quran was revealed to the Prophet in Arabic. And Arabic is the main source of Islam and of Arabic culture.
What are the main flashpoints now in the Middle East? If you could just identify two or three of the main flashpoints, and then we can just look a little closer at each one.
The main flashpoints are the Palestinian-Israeli conflict and the right of the Palestinians to have their own state along the lines of June 1967. So far, there has been no real movement in that direction because of Israeli policies in the occupied Palestinian territories. And the Palestinian-Israeli conflict has been a flashpoint since 1948 because of the absence of a settlement for the Palestine problem. We had the 1956 tripartite aggression against Egypt. We had the 1967 war. We had the 1973 war. We have Israel's invasion of Lebanon in 1982. And we had several wars against Gaza. This is one flashing point. The other flashing point is Iran. And the talk in the West and in Israel about Iranian intentions to build a nuclear program. As far as Iran is concerned, Iran, the reason why the U.S. is taking that position toward Iran has mainly to do with Israel. It has to do with the balance of power
in the Middle East.
Yeah, there is a widespread belief in the West that if Iran were to develop a weaponized nuclear program, that would be a deterrence to Israel. In other words, the balance of power will shift And the U.S. policy and the policy of the Western countries is to guarantee that Israel will always be the dominant hegemonic power in the region. And this is why they don't want Iran to develop a nuclear program. By the way, the Iranians claim that their nuclear program is peaceful.
Yes,
and they
energy.
Have the right to develop a peaceful nuclear program.
Yeah.
There is no evidence, there is no concrete and solid evidence that Iran is embarking on a nuclear military program.
Yes, but the West is of the view, and I'm not saying it's correct, the West is of the view that once they get that capability, then they could easily use it in
whatever
in
way
means
they wish,
other than peaceful energy means.
I disagree with that point of view.
Yes,
the Iranian leadership is not suicidal. Iran knows that if it uses chemical weapons or nuclear weapons against Israel, this will be the end of Iran, the end of the civilization of Iran. If Iran, and I underline the word if Iran is embarking on a weaponized nuclear program, it is because Iran feels that it is surrounded by American naval bases. Iran is threatened on a daily basis by the U.S., by Israel, by the Europeans. Iran is under intrusive, extensive sanctions. And look, if the U.S. is concerned about Cuba, are you surprised to see Iran concerned about the threats that come from Israel and the threats that come from the United States and from the Western European countries?
One couldn't be surprised because there have been expressed positions with respect to how Iran is conducting its affairs and so on. So it's your view that if they move to that, that would be just a balanced power in the Middle East, but not to and would use as a deterrent rather than to be aggressive with it. That's your view you hold?
Exactly. See, if, and I underline this again,
yes,
if Iran is trying to develop a weaponized nuclear program, it is precisely because it wants to create a deterrence. After Iran saw the U.S. invasion of Iraq, Iranian leaders said to themselves, had Iraq had nuclear weapons, the U.S. would not have invaded Iraq.
Yes, whether, all right, so let's go to the first flashpoint, and then we're going to come back and discuss a little bit more on the back end of that conflict. Now, the Israeli-Arab, the Palestinian-Israeli conflict, some commentators are of the view that because it has religious overtones and deep cultural psychological overtones, it's not likely for us to see a fix in the near future. What's your take on the situation and the solutions?
Well, the real issue in the Palestinian-Israeli conflict is that you have an Israel that was created at the expense of the Palestinians in 1948. And in 1948, Israel, by force, occupied about 78% of the total land area of Palestine. Today, and this has been since 1987-88, the Palestinians have publicly and according to agreements, the Oslo Agreement, have recognized Israel within its boundaries of June 1967. In other words, what the Palestinians are seeking is simply 23% of the land area of Palestine. Yes, there is a cultural religious dimension, and this applies to the Palestinians as well as it applies to the Israelis. But the root cause of the problem is not religious, it's not cultural, it is land. The Israelis have grabbed Palestinian land.
Professor Mushi, let's take a quick break and we come back to you. This is a very intriguing, interesting conversation we're having, and the listeners in Jamaica are just swallowing it up. So let's take a break and come back.
Newstalk 93 FM. Heard everywhere.
Buy something from a small business today. Small businesses create jobs and build our economy. Check your label. Make sure what you buy says Made in Jamaica. Support a local business today. A message from the Minister of Industry, Investment and Commerce. The time courtesy of the Minister of Industry, Investment and Commerce is
7:30.
For news updates, the latest information on your favorite news talk programs and lively debates on topical, local and international issues, you can log on to our website at newstalk93fm.com. You can find us on Facebook at facebook.com/newstalk93fm and follow us on Twitter at newstalk93fm. Newstalk93fm. Real news, real talk, heard everywhere.
Newstalk 93 FM. Heard everywhere.
حبيبي يا نور العين يا ساكن خيالي عاشق بقالي سنين ولا غيرك في بالي حبيبي يا نور العين يا ساكن خيالي عاشق بقالي
We are in the Middle East. In Fresh Start.
And in our counterpoint discussion, we're having discussions with Professor Mamad Mushli of Long Island University, who is giving us a better picture just now of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. He had been discussing the issue and the role of land in this conflict.
So let's just rewind a little bit so that we can drive down a couple of things. There is a date you refer to, 1967. Can you just remind us of the relevance of that date and then come forward? Prof?
In June 1967, we had the Arab, the so-called Arab, what the Israelis called the Six-Day War. In that war, Israel occupied the Sinai Peninsula, half of the Suez Canal, that is on the Egyptian side. It also occupied the West Bank, Gaza, and the Syrian Golan. That was in June 1967. There is a basis for resolving the outcome of the 1967 war. UN Security Council Resolution 242, which was adopted in November 1967, that resolution, which was endorsed by the Big Five, unanimously endorsed by the UN Security Council, does not allow for the occupation of other countries' land by force. It calls for mutual recognition and the withdrawal from territories that Israel occupied in June 1967.
That resolution has not been effected.
That resolution has not been implemented because Israel has been colonizing the West Bank on a regular basis. Israel has colonized the Golan Heights, the Syrian Golan, and annexed it in 1981. But Israel has returned to Egypt the territory that it had occupied from Egypt in 1967. As far as the West Bank is concerned, there has been no settlement because of Israeli colonization policies, and the same thing applies to the Golan.
But didn't the PLO, what was the position of the Palestinian organization in relation to
the PLO did recognize Israel implicitly in 1974, explicitly in 1987, and explicitly again in the Oslo Accords of 1993. And Israel also recognized the PLO in 1993. But currently, you have a government in Israel led by Netanyahu who wants to complete the original right-wing, and I underline the way, right-wing Zionist project, which is the absorption of all of Palestine from the Jordan River to the Mediterranean, which means that Netanyahu wants to preclude, wants to kill the possibility of creating a Palestinian state in the West Bank and Gaza.
Can I ask you, Professor Mushri, in amongst what we call the Middle Eastern states, as you had described them and defined them for us this morning, is there no council that can mediate on this issue? Because for those of us here in the West, so to speak, and what we see constantly in the media, when we speak to experts like yourself, there's this constant battle for space and authority and power. Who within the Middle East mediates on this?
Well, the Arabs came with their own initiative in 2002, what is called the Arab Peace Plan, offering Israel recognition, normal relations, and security guarantees in return for Israel withdrawing from the territories it had occupied in June 1967. Till now, Israel has refused the Arab initiative. Now, the only power in the world that has leverage with Israel is the United States. But unfortunately, the United States, given the political system of the United States, the pro-Israeli lobby, which is an alliance of a Jewish lobby and Christian evangelical lobby, have enormous impact on the American Congress. The American Congress supports Israel more than it supports domestic American issues.
You would agree that if we are to see an implementation of 242, Resolution 242, and peace in the Middle East, the United States necessarily will have to play a critical role? Is that what you would agree to?
I really don't foresee or expect Israel to change its policy and accept to withdraw from the West Bank and from the Golan unless the United States really engages itself on a presidential level and work or use its resources to be a fair moderator, a fair referee. But I doubt that the U.S. structurally has that capacity. No American president can challenge, enter into a confrontation with the pro-Israeli lobby.
Well, they would do so at their peril.
Sorry?
No, I say they would do so at their peril.
Any American president who tries to convince Israel, to engage in real peace negotiations and stop its colonization policies in the West Bank, he will be eaten alive.
Now, how do you...
by Congress and by the pro-Israeli lobby.
How do you respond...
Obama tried.
Yes.
Obama tried at the beginning. He wanted Israel to stop the expansion of settlements in the West Bank for just 90 days. And he was neutralized. He was actually neutered politically by Netanyahu.
How do you deal with the... how does Israel, rather, first, view the negotiation process? Do they view the process as Israel negotiating with each state separately? And if so, what's their position on negotiating with the PLO?
Well, to the Israelis, the peace process is a process. What does the word process mean? It means something that is open-ended. The process has been going on since 1991. And the Israeli policy of annexation of establishing settlements in the West Bank and in the Golan as well, the Syrian Golan, has not changed. I really don't see how we can have a Palestinian state in the West Bank and Gaza when Israel has already confiscated and established settlements in about 50% of the West Bank and has sliced up the West Bank into disconnected areas. If you read the Oslo document, which was agreed upon by Israel, talks about the West Bank as one integrated unit. But Israel has cut up that unit.
Prof, we're going to just move in the last 4 minutes of conversation to one other flashpoint we wanted to comment on, and that is what's going on in Egypt and what does it mean for the Middle East, if anything?
Egypt in a process of transition. Egyptian society has been living under military dictatorships from 1952 until February 2011. And now they are trying to chart a new future for the country. The way I see it is that you have two camps in Egypt. You have a camp which is led by the Muslim Brotherhood and a camp that is led by so-called liberal secular forces. And it seems to me that the camp that is led by so-called liberal secular forces is not emotionally or psychologically ready to see a Muslim Brotherhood president winning presidential elections. So the competition between these two camps is going to take some time to resolve itself. I would say we have to wait until December 15, which is a few days away, to see how the Egyptian people are going to vote on the draft of the constitution. That will be submitted to them on December 15. Egypt, of course, is a critical, highly important country. It is the largest Arab country. It is the most powerful Arab country. And it has primacy in America's strategic calculations. So I think one has to wait. It is very difficult to predict the outcome of revolutions.
Certainly.
And what is going on in Egypt is normal. If we put it within the context of a society that is going through the pangs of a revolution.
Professor, we have come to the end of our segment. Thank you very much for sharing your time here with us at News Talk 93 FM. Fresh Start is our program. Thank you very much.
It is my pleasure.
Have a good one. Bless you. That was Professor Mohammed Mushli, Professor of Political Science at Long Island University, New York. Of course, some of the comments would have been opinions being expressed, so you have to sift and weigh and so on. Some basic facts.
These have come from his research, and we're grateful to have been exposed to the work that he's done, especially in respect of understanding the West Bank and Gaza, particularly because we pick up these terms and use them locally.
Yes, we do.
And they will understand what it means back in the Middle East. Eh?
All right. So, and again, we say there are opinions. This is a commentary program. It's a magazine program. So there are opinions that were expressed. You must decide if you accept or not. Well, let's take a little break. And when we come back from the break, we will continue with today's program. And we have a little plug for you.
Welcome back to Fresh Start. I'm Sharon Hay Webster.
And I'm Clyde O'Donnell St. James Williams.
Clyde O.J. Williams. Okay. This morning we're in our blog segment. And this is a short feature segment where we are looking this morning with the president of the Jamaica Institution of Engineers, Dr. David Smith. Good morning, Dr. Smith.
Good morning. How are you?
I'm well, thanks. Boy, that voice sounds authoritative and in charge. Is it not? Yes, man. All right, we understand that you're a coastal engineer, Dr. Smith.
That's correct.
Tell us what a coastal and who a coastal engineer is. Have I got it correctly? What do you do, and why is it important for us? Yes.
A coastal engineer would perhaps start off as a civil engineer.
Yes.
And then through a process of specialization would develop an expertise in what we call coastal engineering. So it's really the interaction between the land and the sea is what it is.
Okay.
So you deal with the development of ports and so on?
So, yes, design of ports, design of sea defense works, where land may be threatened. A lot of the work that we do also relates to assisting countries in predicting areas that may be vulnerable to storm surge and tsunami impacts,
right.
You know, sort of mapping out sections of the shoreline where residents may be threatened by these natural hazards.
Given the current climate change environment,
we always include climate change in our design.
Right, and the current Jamaica Institute of Engineers Awards, what kind of weighting was there with respect to climate change in respect of your consideration of projects?
I think there was some weighting involved with it. But we also, I guess with our projects, we had two sets of awards this year, Product of the Year and Project Since Independence. So in terms of the Product of the Year, which I think is the one that you're discussing this morning, we look at projects that have been outstanding for the year in terms of impact on the society and just general scope, whether the input from local companies and a number of factors really that came into it.
And which project won, and if you could probably just quickly say why that project tipped the scale?
Well, we had quite a few projects this year. We had digital headquarters. We had the National Water Commission Water Supply Improvement Project, which is the one that won. We had some bridges. We had a section of Highway 2000 that was a candidate this year. We had the Dry River Bridge, which was done by Kira Construction. We had a bridge by China Harbor, which was the Rio Grande Bridge. I believe that the Water Supply Improvement Project was the chosen one because of its general impact. I mean, it included rehabilitation and refurbishment of the Rio Cobra pipe. It looked at the Constant Spring and Seaview water treatment plants and work improvements in the Stonehill distribution system and Kingston Town water supply scheme. So it was quite far-reaching, we felt. And, you know, to paraphrase, NWC, water is life, right? So
yes.
But we felt that this one was deserving of the Project of the Year.
Give us some landmarks with this project, because I'm trying to see if I can get a visual of...
Well, do you have Guy Walters on the line as well?
No.
We only have you this morning, right.
Mm-hmm. Okay, I thought that Guy is a representative from National Water Commission.
No, we don't have Gary.
Okay.
So just some visual.
The Rio Cobra aspect, it included, I think, over 6 kilometers of pipeline were laid under the road. So it was a bit of work involved there. It involved the construction of a new chlorination facility at Bidos. As I said, it included the refurbishment of the Constant Spring and easy water treatment plants, and allowed for quite a bit of improvement capacity and treatment of water through those plants, using chemical dosing
systems
and settling tanks and so on. We look at desertifying systems. So I think the project also, I believe, included replacement of over of close to 70,000 domestic and commercial meters.
Okay.
So it had a fair impact, we felt, on society at large.
Yes, of course, and I can well imagine the impact is being felt
as we speak.
Let me ask you this: the Digicel building, what from an engineering standpoint? Because I guess that's so visual downtown; everybody can probably quickly identify with it. Those
very visual, but the building is also unique. And it was an interesting design because it. Well, it incorporated some very interesting, green building technologies, we call it, right? So it was unique in that way, we felt.
Give us a couple of these little bits of what green building technology
means.
It had on the roof of the building, it was designed to be one of the most environmentally friendly large office buildings in Jamaica and in the Caribbean, in fact.
Right.
And the buildings had, I think, over 700 square meters of solar photovoltaic panels. It also had some wind turbines, four wind turbines.
I've
seen that, right.
You saw that, right?
Yes.
I think it had over 1,300 square meters of solar hot water collectors to
Oh, that's all. That's all the extra things that we see on the sides, and we're not sure what they are.
Yeah.
Okay.
And the exterior of the building, external facade of the building, has hurricane resistant glass, which it's a tempered glass. So it's able to withstand not just the wind, but objects hitting it.
Is it waterproof? If there's a tsunami, would they be in the building and be protected?
Yes.
Wow.
You could be. And it incorporated aluminum louvered shading for the windows, right? So
yes, we've seen that.
It was quite a what we call a state of the art green building. And apparently, the sanitary facilities in the building itself. They use low water consumption units.
Yes. Engineers in government. We want more engineers in government.
That's a mantra he has, Dr. Smith, I'll tell you.
No, I'm telling you, we need some more engineers in the parliament.
Well, Digicel has quite a few engineers, and in fact, we're very pleased to see that some of their engineers have become members of our Jamaica Institution of Engineers.
Wonderful.
Okay. Do you want to tell us about your membership?
Actually.
Tell us about your membership, Dr. Smith.
Our membership now.
Just a minute.
What's that? Sorry.
We just have 1 minute left to go for the telling us about the organization. Go right ahead, please.
Okay, I'll make it brief. We have approximately close to 600 members, but I would say actively we have about 300 or so, 300 to 400 members are active. We would like to be able to improve our membership, increase our membership this year. At least half of our members are civil engineers, and then the other disciplines comprise the remaining 50%. We're going to try to go on a drive to bring in more members if we can this year. I think there's still a lot of engineers practicing in society who are not members of our institution, or in fact who are not registered engineers in Jamaica, which is not a good thing in our opinion.
Yes.
We have a number of events planned for the coming year, which include our annual Engineers Week. It's a week of conferences and seminars, and we showcase technology, basically. And between between now and then. That's in September of 2013, approximately.
We're going to plug you again next year so that we can, because we want to promote engineering a little bit more in our society. People need to understand we need to build environmentally friendly.
Definitely the way to go.
Gotta run, Doctor David.
All right, we'll take care. Good talking to you both.
Wonderful.
Yeah, sure. Well, good.
Listeners,
Thank you too.
Have a good one. Go straight to Heads Up. After Heads Up, BBC Business News, and you come back with the big picture.
With the big man, Pernell.
I totally understand when someone wants to put a little color in their hair. Not that they don't like their original hair color, but it's just that sometimes a little change is just what we need. Need a hair color touch-up? Here are some good tips to do it right. Think inside the box. Before you hit the cosmetic shelves of your local drugstore, ask yourself, how much of a commitment am I willing to make? Then, pick a formula based on your comfort level. Semi-permanent dye is a good temporary option. It rinses away after about 10 shampoos, and so you won't be left with those telltale roots. Since semi-perms don't use peroxide or ammonia, they can't lighten your hair or give you a drastic color transformation. They only deposit pigment, enhancing or adding depth to your current shade. If you're ready to commit to a serious color change, you want a permanent option. These dyes alter your shade with peroxide and ammonia, so the color will last until it gets cut or until it grows out. These formulas give you the most versatility in how you can alter your color, enabling you to achieve more drastic results. Deep condition. Don't even think about applying color without using a hair conditioner. If your hair is damaged, the pigment won't adhere well to your strands and it will end up looking streaky. So, at least 1 week before coloring, pamper your hair with a deep conditioning treatment. Giving your strands a dose of intense hydration also helps to protect them from the harsh chemicals that are used in coloring, so you can avoid fried, crispy ends. Lastly, do your prep work. Before you even rip open the box, apply a thin layer of Vaseline along your hairline, from earlobe to earlobe and along your neckline, in order to prevent the dye from staining your skin. A little color can be a good thing if you know the right way to do it. If you follow these tips, you will be okay, I can assure you. Add a little color to your life, the right way, and enjoy the beauty that comes from change.
Welcome back to Fresh Start, here with us at News Talk 93 FM on the Mona campus of the University of the West Indies. I am Sharon Hay Webster.
And I am Clyde Williams.
And this morning we're in our big picture segment. We're going to be having discussions with Pernell Charles in respect of flexi work time. But our technology has given us a little challenge this morning, but we'll soon make contact with him. The flexi work time, Clyde, is... As it says, it was work time, meaning defining hours of work in new space to allow flexibility, which is why you say flexi work time. In law, it was changing legislation to allow persons to be able to negotiate hours of work so that you would work with the concept of the 40-hour work week, but it would not have to be Monday to Friday, 8 to 4 or 9 to 5, which is our traditional work week standard. And there had been some discussions for quite some time about putting in place this flexi work time, particularly because of instances, for example, like change in traffic, as we've seen happen with, for example, those of us who live in Portmore, and the difference in terms of having to drop off children and being able to get to work on time, as well as picking up your family responsibilities. So there was a concept of looking at putting shorter hours Monday to Friday and then picking up the balance of the 40-hour work week on a Saturday or Sunday, dependent on your religious observances. But there were many points put forward in respect of that, speaking about energy conservation, more pressure on buildings and management, because it means then that management is going to have to be structured to be at work in terms of supervisor level if you're coming in on a weekend. But we've seen a difference, for example, with supermarkets and opening times, and difference in terms of...
Well, those are easy to have flexi hours in.
Easier, yes, I mean, and those were the examples that were used.
Those kinds of retail stores kind of set up much easier.
Those were easier.
For instance, an engineering company, you know, or a financial services sector company. The question I have, attitudinally, you think we're ready for it?
But it's already...
Just attitudinally, because I don't think attitudinally we're in the right place for productivity. And I think...
Why don't you think so?
Because we have low productivity. We have always had, for a long time, low productivity. The output from our work is just low, and it's below international standards, you know, all around the country. And not leaving out any sector. Productivity low, that's a big part of Jamaica's problem.
But what I
work
find...
attitudes.
But what I find, however, is that when we have to move into another space... We comply with the rules and regulations.
Systems.
And those same systems allow many of us to rise and even overtake it. I look at, for example, the hotel on Mackinac Island in Michigan. It's 85% staffed by Jamaicans.
Right.
And in fact, one Jamaican is a vice president of that hotel. And he rose from the position of a kitchen steward. And when you watch all of them, they are working. It's fabulous to
systems.
Watch the interaction. So in that case, if we see those systems there that have worked for us, and where our farm work persons have to be fitting within that system and doing well, why therefore can't we utilize those systems here?
Yeah, but it's not so easy,
and
because systems are systemic. They're cultural. They're patterns that you develop over a long period of time, which our values and so on don't really readily make for developing those kinds of systems and patterns of steady, continuous, repetitious behavior. We have some attitudinal issues. And when Mr. Patterson had raised those questions, work attitude is a big part of it. And when I use work, I'm not referring to blue-collar work. I'm referring to work.
Generally.
That's right. Our work output, our productivity is low. Our attitudes, as Nicole Rain set up, so we're ready for staying away and
not
go.
No, not only that, you have people who say they stay away from work on a birthday, yeah, because it's your birthday, so you don't go to work.
So I'm telling you. So we have some real profound attitudinal issues, work attitude and not otherwise, that people would be a little bit worried about implementing flexi because of that very problem we have.
But you have some information there on a study, Clyde. You want to share that with us?
A two-year-old Ministry of Labour, this is reported in the Gleaner of July 15, 2012. A two-year-old Ministry of Labour and Security study on flexi work concludes that employers face no additional administrative capital or security costs by allowing flexible working arrangements, while workers complained of reduced remuneration. The findings resulted from a survey of 6 companies and 2 trade unions representing workers done via interviews. The report, Flexible Work Arrangements, an examination of its implementation in Jamaica organizations, found that in 3 of the 3 instances of reduced work week, there were reports that there was a reduction in labor costs. The most negative outcome reported was that some workers objected to the change and also reported to receiving less pay. Among the participating companies, two types of flexi arrangements practice: the staggered work week and the reduced work hours. Flexible work arrangements were considered to be particularly successful in two instances where staggered work hours were implemented, and also in one instance where reduced work week was used. The arrangements were successful because they benefited both employers and employees. And you can look at that article, Google if you wish, Glean aside, July 15, 2012, and speaking about that. So for many persons, Sharon, they are very cautious about those changes, aside from the security dimension, because there is that security dimension in terms of staggered hours or reduced hours. This had become a lot more significant in discussion when the public sector, under the previous administration, the facing of cutting staff or cutting hours each person work, so that
to allow more people to be able to stay, so that within the same set of monies that you had budgeted, that you would allow everybody to stay but allow the work hours to be shifted, so more families would still have steady income coming in.
Those kinds of agreements in Jamaica are very extremely difficult to hammer out because of a variety of reasons and factors, and some of them listeners might come to mind, but they are not very easy to hammer out, because the unions have a vested interest in what is and what they are, the benefits to the workers now.
But the unions also have to look at the fact that they must try and keep as many people working as possible.
Well, I don't
so
know.
They need to, but you see, but well, come on, it makes sense.
Yes, I accept that, but I'm saying I don't know if their headspace is there, that they think that is, that, you know, it's problematic. It's not a very simple. So we have that approach. Then we have the staggering, the work hours approach.
Explain the staggering for us.
So some people would come on at, let's say,
pardon me,
factory. Some people would come on in the evening and work through till 11, 12, 1, 2, whatever the hours are, and they would produce in those circumstances. So the pressure, they would have less pressure in the mornings in terms of congestion on the road, the patterns.
This was a very sticky point because of the issue of security and crime.
Yeah.
And you know, funny enough, this morning when I was coming down and I was looking at I was coming up West King's House, I was looking at people walking, going to work at Megamark this morning. This is after 5.
Yes.
So many of us, when we see somewhere open at a particular time, we don't understand how early some people have to get there to begin the day. And therefore then, if we're going to go to flexi work time, the state has to look at what systems it has in place to protect workers.
Yes.
So the issue of security is key. So there's patrol on the streets. And remember, there's also...
But you can generalize that across the country. That would be very difficult if you...
No, what I was going to, however, is that there is areas of cooperation that had been worked out between private sector security firms and the public sector, as in police and military, in the sense that those who provide personal security services at homes and within communities, as you have the gated communities, are now, that they are part of that securing... pardon me, the nation in total as a partnership.
Well,
because of this factor too.
I'm concerned about, you know, because we could easily find a situation where some sectors get more patrolling and other sectors don't. But in this study, there were two reported instances in which flexi work arrangements proved unsuccessful, both featuring a reduced work week. For obvious reasons, you know, workers would complain about that.
Yeah, they would. Well, not
the arrangements, quote, were unsuccessful because they were designed to primarily benefit the employers.
Right.
Consequently, there were reports of dissatisfaction and grievances among the employees. The researchers said the study states that the impact of the arrangements on costs was varied.
Okay.
So
now we're finally joined by Mr. Charles. Hello, morning.
Well, morning.
Mars Parnell, morning. Sorry, we're trying to get you a little earlier, so I need to give you the background of the discussion we've been having so far. There's something on in the background. Can I ask you to turn that down, please, either radio or TV?
Yes.
Okay. We're supposed to be having discussions with you this morning about the flexi work time legislation and the concept. Do you want to tell us about your experience with it as former minister that had to handle this matter?
Are you on here now?
Yes, we are, sir.
Sorry. Yes, well, first let me say to you that Flexi Work Week was designed to do two major things. One, increase production. Two, increase employment. Sound funny? Let's examine it. We accept that the normal work week is 2 hours a week. So we said that based on the present situation, people work at 40 or over 5 days. As one man says, as you bathe and put on your clothes and reach work, you have to go back home. So, all right. We said, okay, how can we achieve the 40 work week, the 40 hours in a shorter work week and either get somebody else to do the work or you do overtime? Now, since it is for production and for employment, we say, all right, you can do your 40 hours in 3.5 days. You have a day and a half that you can do either with your children, other type of work, or something else. Get somebody else onto the job that would increase employment. We discover also, we say, all right, we put it up to maximum 12 hours, maybe 14. So, 4 days, you actually finish your 40-hour work week. We put a stop on it and say, well, some people want to be 40 hours straight. Say, no, that would be killing the hen that is supposed to lay that golden egg. So it's a maximum 14. Normally we say 12 hours a day. The major part of this is to have employers and employees educated to the objectives of the flexi work week. If we don't have the workers buying to it, if we don't have the employers buying to it, it will never work. If we have an employee say, listen man, me no busy with nobody else, we want all the overtime that is possible because my mortgage is high and my to get work. Then without looking at somebody else, they are tired at work, they are sleeping, productivity is as is the lowest in the Caribbean, in Jamaica.
It's horrible.
Horrible?
Yes.
That's a decent work that is here worthy.
And between 90... Mr. Charles, this is Clyde Williams. How you do?
Hey, Clyde, what you doing?
There, sir. And between 1972, Jamaica Productivity Center Research inaugural annual productivity summary report released November of 2009. The report covers the period 72 to 2007 and found that there was a decline of 1.3% per annum in terms of the output of Jamaican workers between 72 and 2007.
Right.
So
well, you know that I Andrew Gallimore and myself, we could take some credit with working with Joe Matalan and he was very upset, I forget his name, but the gentleman who was in charge there.
Don't worry about it.
Doctor, something or another. All right. It is a good program. The objectives are good, but none of the objectives that we have in Jamaica can work if we don't bind to it, educate ourselves, and work towards it. Okay.
It might cause productivity to further plummet. That is concern of many persons because we tend not to like a structured, rigorous environment. And once you talk flexi hours, greater responsibilities then imposed on employees, on management, and all concerned to make it work.
Let me disturb you on that and give some credit to Lambert Brown, who at Kaiser increased productivity. The workers had more time and they got more pay.
So what we're waiting on?
Yeah, why can't that model be put elsewhere?
Well, there's so many things in Jamaica you can ask. the question, yeah, why?
But Kaiser, you know, Kaiser is a multinational. Kaiser is one of those. Kaiser is a transnational company.
Kaiser is one of the multinationals that bought into it, because look at this quickly. When you have a three-shift work with trucks, you know that by the time a man know that his time is coming up, half hour before him finish, you know, in slowdown, and half hour to start the slowdown, you literally lose an hour production in that. Now, when you double a man hours, and he knows he's going to have to do X amount, he does it. So the employers, having discovered the lowering of productivity, shifting away from the normal work week to contract and say, listen, man, I don't care whether you want to work it in 1 day, 3 days, 4 days, you know, you're getting X amount of money for this.
Ah, okay.
Man don't take lunchtime. Him come early. Him don't lean up on him home. Him don't go home early. And him finish and gone. There are many ways in which, you know, the normal Jamaican culture can increase productivity. But you see, you can't be in a developing country and act like you're a developed country, and you take coffee break and smoke break and
buy
and
expensive cars.
Sell break and all these breaks.
Mr. Charles, you know, you hear me a while ago.
And
buy expensive cars. And I'm talking government, I'm talking us as a people. Love bling. Listen.
Well, I tell you something.
Yes.
Most of us would like to get a car.
Yes.
And most of us, you know, after you get a car, you want to get a pretty car.
Right.
But all the cars can do the same function.
Thank you very much, sir.
Car over house.
That's right. Well, you know, listen, that black American culture had seeped in when man have big car and no house. Let's take a break and come back, Mr. Charles. Just a moment, please.
Welcome back to Fresh Start. Here with us in the big picture this morning, I'm Sharon Hay Webster.
I'm Clyde Williams, and we have Chief Pernell Charles here with us. How are you doing, Chief?
Chief, you're back with us.
Can I jump back in and say something that I think is very important?
Yes, go ahead.
Now, how does it help the employer who is listening? An employer who has somebody running a machine, and that person runs that machine for 12, 13, 14 hours. He has to pay that person for 8 hour normal work and 6 hours, 1.5 times, on some occasion, up to 3 or 4 times, depending on holiday and night and this and that. So he discovered that for 14 hours, he has to literally pay twice. So it is easier for him to use 2 employees fresh after 8 hours, right, and achieve higher productivity, give a next man work. How it helps the employee, he, as I said, can finish his work in 3.5 days, either get another job or find some valuable time with his children, his family, his farm or something. It is a work, and it is a win-win for everybody.
Hasn't there been the buy-in then?
Only certain sectors, though.
Tell me one that you would say.
Because Sean raises the buy-in point. Let's take, for instance, the financial sector. How would you see that working in the financial sector in context where we have a security issue in the country?
Security?
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Look here, man. Every country have thief. Every country have decent people. I hear one man say, if you're not Adventist or the other church here, they're not going to hire you. I can't remember Adventist because I am.
No worry about it.
there's no truth in all of this. You interview a man, you check his background. There's so many unemployed youth who are honest, dying for a job.
I'm not thinking about them. I'm thinking about the perception that a businessman takes to the table, that he cannot afford to pay any more. Either is going to be extortion money.
But I'm trying to help him with that. He is unable to pay overtime because he's paying more money than what productivity he's getting from a tired worker. So I am giving him an opportunity to say to this man, you are going to work 8 hours, and I'm going to put on somebody else for another 8 hours. I get 2 8-hour work at normal working time.
Will the state...
Rather than 16 hours, 8 at normal time, and the other 8 at time and a half.
Will the state
you
provide...
Cut out all of that.
Will the state then provide... Does the state have the capacity to provide those support services required now to support the many hundreds, possibly thousands of workers on flexi hours?
As in transport and security.
Look here. Let's go back to round one. You are driving a bus for a man, and he wants to run his bus 14 hours a day. We say, to have a driver driving 14 hours is jeopardizing the life of so many people. Let that driver drive for 8 hours. For the next 6 hours, you employ somebody else. You have thousands, hundreds of good drivers around the place. It does not. It is a buying for people to sit at the dining table or sit with a professional and look at the thing. The worker probably will say, look, I am the most disadvantageous in this matter because I'm going to lose my overtime. But I said to you, you have 2 extra days. You can either get another job or work something out with your family, stay with your children, help them. There's so many things because you're going to get your 40-hour work week because the employer is saying that the overtime that he has to pay time and a half for, he's not getting even half the production.
Why the timidity then? If all of what you say can be supported by the research and anecdotal evidence and otherwise, why then the timidity in the country?
Look here, man. Go to the productivity center. Speak to the people there. Let them outline and show you how they have increased productivity for certain factories in Jamaica by just going there to turn off light when a man turning back on it.
I see.
By just going and turn off air conditioner that the man leave running and gone a seat for 1 hour. There's a lot of things that can be done and should be done that if we don't do it, we'll keep borrowing people money, taking it to the supermarket, buy food with it, eat it, go to the toilet the next day and have to borrow again.
So Pernell, who is holding up the show? Because somebody's holding up the show. Who is holding up the show?
Well, I'm not sure it's the politician this time.
We're not sure on the card, you know.
We put it out there, Clyde.
Yes.
But it's been out there a long time, Pernell, a very long time. It's sat in Parliament across 2 administrations.
Right, and I got first flexi-week through the Parliament, got flexi-week on board, got most of the amendments to be done there, and gave instructions, not instructions, I don't like to instruct people, advise the worker and the employer that they can jump off with it right now. Some people are doing it.
Okay.
Take small business. I had a small business conference. I saw 4 young ladies sit at the table, giggling and laughing. All sort of things run through my mind. Who are these women? They happen to be the owner of a small business.
Okay.
The 4 of them are at the same level. The 4 of them sweep floor, cook, wash, produce, sell. And they will be tripling their productivity. And tripling their employment soon.
Are there some...
We have some man to give him a contract. As they give him a contract, him sit down from the bank side and employ somebody. Him done work. Yeah. It's a contract now.
I see.
There's a whole lot of things that has to be changed in the society. Don't care what the parliamentarian does. Don't care what they say.
So right? How come you never support when Mr. Patterson was talking? Or you never give Mr. Patterson the values and attitude support, man?
what are you talking about? You know,
I'm
a country boy, you know.
I'm pulling your tongue, man. I know I'm not serious.
Well, it hurts.
Ouch.
Let me tell you something.
I am saddened. You know why? Because the worst part of this bad foot is at the top.
Mm.
It's not at the toe. The toe is ready to move. The workers will come along if you teach them and show them what they are getting.
So it's leadership, Pernell.
So if you still want to come to work at 10 o'clock and go and play golf for three, and at the end of the year, balance sheet can't match up.
Yes.
Well, so it's leadership then, Colonel. Huh?
You are reading chapter what in my new book.
And it seems to me that you're saying it's both public leadership, sector and private sector leadership.
It is leadership in every way. Let me show you, Clyde. No, you want to run.
Don't worry, man. We're only 4 minutes.
It is leadership for the father who go home when the children are asleep and leave while they are still asleep and leave everything to the wife to cook, dress, carry them to school, see that they do the homework.
What a worthless man.
When graduation comes, I'm the first man sitting on the front.
I want a photograph.
It is leadership at all levels.
How are we going to change that, Colonel? How are we going to change that? If we know that that's a difficulty, and for you as someone who's been come from the unions in terms of dealing with workers, come from the political party and come from parliament, you have three sets of standards that you can look at. Tell us, how can we get this change that can shift Jamaica and put us back to where Singapore saw us as good and passed us? How do we pass Singapore now, given what you're saying about the leadership factor?
Well, let me say this to you. We are heading to the worst part of the gully we have ever entered. This coming year, I cannot see beyond January.
That's what
I need a new eye.
Yes, but that's what Mr. Charles, that's what the supporters of the other side said when you were the government. That
look here, man.
Yes, I do accept
Look here.
Never have.
If we are going to start the side on government, we're not going to make the move.
All right, that's why I want you to finish, Colonel. Because you're not speaking.
I'm asking you, are you saying that you're not speaking on a JLP ticket?
Is that what you're saying?
Nobody talking about ticket here.
Mr. Charles.
You can't separate out yourself.
I am telling you right now.
You cannot separate out yourself. I'm saying, Mr. Charles.
Can you blow into
Jamaicans? Jamaicans. Colonel.
You have not understand this young man.
Colonel, I talk to the class. Colonel, Jamaicans have disconnected from the politics precisely because it's destructive. When you form the administration, the PMP voices said things are going to crash very soon. Right. Now the PMP forms the administration, the Labour Party voices say things are going to crash and are crashing.
Can I stop you right there? Yes, I'm tired of that.
Don't bring it up today.
Because our objective is power. If I help them now, I'm going to keep them in power. If they accept what I say, they're going to put me in power. Power is the problem that this country is facing in the political system. The leaders don't have the guts. They don't have the will. They don't have what it takes to stand up and say, this is the way I go. The first way I have, why is going to make me lose? I'm going to make me win. You're going to make me lose. I'm going to make me win.
But we talk
say
eloquently. We talk eloquently, Colonel, when we in the opposition.
Guys, all listen to me. Do you know that year before the last year, I was the first cabinet minister that assembled the unions and the private sector at the Pegasus and told them that the international financial debacle, I call it a tsunami that was coming, was going to wipe us out. I did that. And after that, I hear that I was not part of the government because the government knows nothing. And up to today, I was not recognized. This little black boy, and I have no talk.
Well, you know it going to Jamaica.
I can't talk.
Yes,
you guys don't listen to me.
No, well, you're better than that with me.
One question I want to ask you again, Mas Pernell. You're closing, can you just tell us, is there hope that we can have, that we can pass this tsunami as you're speaking of?
That is all of us.
You know something? Please do not ask me to make a public statement on that.
Thank you very much. Listen.
Because you know why? If I make a public statement, it is a little bad. And I tell you why.
There must be hope.
Hold on. Listen to this. We have a bright
a more brilliant, more educated set of young people today than we had in the past. Where are they after they leave the university? Where are you guys?
You want me to answer that?
Politics is dedicated. Is any special man?
Pernell, you want me really?
You guys not going to go through what we have gone through.
Yeah, but
you're not going to put
it. Not even give you a chance to go to the wicket. Pernell.
You're not going there.
Pernell, you're not even giving us a chance to put on the pads, put on the tips, take up a bat and go to the wicket.
Hold on, Clyde. Who gave me the chance?
Eh?
Who gave me the chance?
Oh, so I saw it go.
You have to take your space.
Who gave Colonel Charles a chance to be what he is? So I ask you now.
I'm
the most senior parliamentarian in the country. If you add the Senate and the Parliament.
Well,
I went to the Senate in 1967 and in 2012.
Well, you were appointed.
Parliament. Mr. Who gave me that chance?
The person who appointed to the Senate, who was that?
All
right,
the
so
one.
There you go. You got a break, right? We just said, burn it.
We're
not crowd the space
score,
away.
And that score, you're right.
Yeah, we're not crowd the space. Here we go.
No. And that score, you're right. And there are a number of young people
that's right.
who need that break.
That's right. And Michael Manley on the other side did the same
hold
thing.
On. Guys, I never get a break in life. I kick them.
Yes, all right.
My father tell me, no man can hold
him
boy.
But
you're
getting
right. In can't sleep, you get uplifting. In can't eat, you get uplifting. Anything in there, you get uplifting. No man can hold me down.
Yeah, man.
All right, Colonel. Thank you, Chief. Colonel, we're going to pull you back for more discussion, but we come to the end this morning. Sorry we didn't have you from the start, but you're unnoticed. You're unnoticed that I'm bringing you back to come contend back with Clyde, because I have a ticket for you.
Hold on, no. When
I love him. He's my friend, man.
Yeah, man. Long time.
Again, I'm not recognized, but tell him need me.
We go far back. Listen, Pernell, you see, when they have your send-off in a parliament, your farewell, we need 1 week. Because you have too much color.
My union background, my 46 years in the trade union, I have hundreds of people listening to me now who are living in house because of my investment in them.
That's cool.
Because of my investment.
Gotta run.
You know?
Gotta
run. Chief.
Work because of my investment.
Okay.
And I was barefoot at 14.
Gotta run.
All right, Chief. We want to share that more of that
Give
story
thanks.
With you next morning.
All right, cool.
Well, good.
Colonel.
Whoops.
Color. We have to
always
break, and come back. Welcome back to Fresh Start. We are in the home stretch. Newstalk93fm.com is where we stream live. We have a few callers. Good morning, caller.
Hello.
Yeah, man.
Wagwan.
Midday, what you say?
Miss Sharon.
Oh, thank you very much. Good morning. What's up now?
That discussion there with the man with the Palestinian issue, why?
Yes.
You know, when I listen to that discussion, I come to the conclusion that I wholly support Obama because he's the best of a worst type.
Okay.
I come to that conclusion.
Oh, yes, is that a compliment?
Yes.
No, because look, you know, when you take out the American policies and the hypocrisy, and even since Obama come in, what has Obama do to really bring peace between the Palestinians and Israelis?
Yes, he
does nothing.
The American state is a complex state, and it's run by largely an industrial, military, financial complex. He has some maneuverability, but it is very, very in a restricted area. So don't knock him too hard. He's doing what he can within the American system.
I am knocking him, Clive, because he's a part of American hypocrisy. In Canada, you just have to do what the American people want.
All right, well, let's explore that some more.
That's
all right, so listen and let's see how we explore that.
If the Jamaican leaders did what we want, it'll be all right. We're gone.
I want a minute to go up on Clive's case now.
Yes.
Clive, yesterday was International Human Rights Day.
Right.
As the position where you hold as part of the human rights issue, did you play a role yesterday? Otherwise, from the very good discussion you have on the radio yesterday.
Yeah, man. I represented some persons on issues having to do with their rights for several hours. I was engaged.
And you were at the meeting with Jamaican for justice yesterday too?
No, I wasn't deep in it.
I missed it and I support all night.
But I support 100%
their initiative.
Alliance. Yes. To begin to establish minimum standards for our children in Jamaica.
Absolutely.
Absolutely.
We're gone.
All right. Well, good.
Yeah.
Hello, morning.
Morning.
Morning, what's up?
Morning, who?
good morning. What's up? What's on your mind?
Sorry. What's up?
Yes.
Values and attitude.
You mean they're down?
Huh?
They're down.
You know why I am glad I was listening to you this morning? Ask Mr. Patterson where he got this thing from. You know why I couldn't manage it? It was taken from the program I have, and it's the end product of the program.
Yeah, but come on.
Hold on a minute.
You don't have a copyright over values and attitudes.
Hold on.
That's a universal thing, Paddy.
No. I have a program to bring out the same attitude where you're talking about that is missing in the workplace and everywhere.
Okay.
So you don't understand what I'm saying? That total program will involve the social part, the social capital, education, economics, everything. Now, I have values and attitude. This thing spoke to attitude and action. I have two abstract work can't work together.
Listen.
I share the program with him and ask him to sit down and listen and allow assisting me.
Let's come forward. Come on forward.
The whole problem is, until that program I have here is allowed, this attitude thing cut cross everywhere, but he doesn't know what it is.
We're going to accept. All right,
here what I needed to do. Go share that to the Ambassador White Man. Then, since he's Ambassador White Man. All right, then. I encourage you to talk to him and then see how you can bring it forward.
That is not going to help.
We're taking some more cards.
Good. All right, then. Hello, morning. How are you doing?
Good morning.
Morning.
Miss Webster.
Yes, morning.
Hi, pretty lady.
How you doing?
Not too bad. Interesting talk with you, Mr.
Pernell Charles.
Yes.
But what is the other day I was saying to myself, I wasn't hearing funny, man.
In there, man.
And all of a sudden, I hear him come and say nobody can hold him down. But you can't him get too long in a party, man. In all the opposition.
But I'm in the country. Listen, Mr. Charles is past 70 years old. Mr. Charles
He's part of the council of elders of the party.
And
right.
That's right. Different role they're playing now.
Thank you very much. All right.
All right.
Welcome.
Thank you, Miss Webster.
All right. Hello, morning.
Hello.
Somebody's radio is going.
All right.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Here. Yes, morning.
Please good morning.
Please turn the radio down.
Oh, sorry. Could
yeah, man. We're humans. We err every now and again. I know nothing.
Hello?
She gone. Turn it down, man. She's
all right. Can you hear me now?
Yes, very clearly.
Interesting talk you had with Charles a while ago.
Yes.
Uh-huh. And he said something interesting to Clyde. Clyde, you wanted to be handed to you as youngsters and a plaza. He went out and took his opportunity
to
serve.
Yes, but Mr. Shearer appointed him to the Senate at a young age.
But
so
he had to be
in Mr. Shearer's sight for him to do
right,
that, don't it?
Him.
Thank
yes,
you.
Well,
right, he never sat back and wanted it down a plaza.
Well, let me tell you something what goes on in Jamaica.
Mm-hmm.
You know too. If you are assertive and develop your own mind and positions, but you still broadly subscribe to the party's view, you don't really get too very far in a lot of these parties.
No, man, that's not true.
True?
Well, Peter Phillips challenged him as him step in as a youngster. Him challenged Bobby Pickard's girl.
Yeah, and what
never
happened?
Afraid.
That wasn't youngster, honey. That was 95. Hello. Peter was not a youngster in 1995. I don't forget that one because that was on my birthday. That was...
and him challenged several other challenges.
That
so
is true,
afraid.
but him was
right.
Not a youth.
So I'm going to ask you this.
It means that would have been a senior youth.
Let me ask you.
Was young
I want to put a question to you.
Mm-hmm.
Would you agree that we have not had the kind of replenishing of our parties and the renewals that we really would want in our parties? Would you agree with that as a generally correct statement?
No, not in the broad sense that you have placed it. What has not replenished is the ideology of the PMP as I knew it when I joined as a youngster in high school.
Okay.
The ideological outlook in which guided it when it was formed has been lost for the last maybe 10
years. So what about
is it a matter of lust or that it has changed internationally and therefore Jamaica has been part of that change?
No, it is not that it has changed internationally because the group that we support and the ideological outlook and the principles that we support are still there, even more now pronounced.
That's
but
right.
What has happened internally is that it has been pushed behind the scenes.
All right, but what about personal change? We have another call, so you just have about another 30 seconds or so. What about personal change?
Well, you see some good quality youngsters stepping forward.
Yes, okay.
Clive, one last question.
Yes.
Who is the opposition in Singapore?
We don't know.
Okay, all right.
Different culture, listen, party.
Okay,
you,
red
one
culture.
One thing we do, though, when you come in, you have some ball with your boat from the back of your hand, you know.
All right, okay.
Have a wonderful
you
day.
You need to go join West Indies side.
Yeah,
walk good.
Yes.
Hello, morning. Hello?
Yeah, morning.
Morning. Yeah. You're serious this morning. What's
hold
up?
On. Hold on. Before you go, let me put on my helmet. Come.
No, man, you're cool, man. Me no go so bad.
I'm just troubling you. Go ahead.
I know. Yeah. Here it is. And as you, I forgot to answer me still. So, here. I remember after the 5-year strict here with in the Pratt and Morgan ruling.
Yes.
That Trinidad, I think it was, carried out some execution.
I recall quite well.
Yes, they have not been able to do it since.
Yes.
No, I got the impression that when they did it, it was because they did something that was unorthodox. And this is why they have not been able to carry out any execution.
It had caused a furor in the country because the persons who were on death row had not exercised and exhausted all the appeals
exactly
and processes given to them by their country's agreement with
listen,
international bodies.
You are on top of the point I want to make. You know why I said?
Well, I'm not going to bring it with me anyway.
There's a talk show host, you
yes,
see?
Yes.
He keeps saying, he's a...
Don't call any station.
No, man, hear okay. what he says. He's a strong proponent for capital punishment.
Yes.
And so he keeps on saying that it is because of a lack of political will.
Oh, yes.
The,
I heard it yesterday. Right, yes.
Right.
Yes.
And say all we need to do if we want to carry out capital punishment is to amend the law. He has no regard, it seems, for the fact that we are signatories to so many international conventions.
And the fact that the Privy Council will find a way in it because of a policy position on the issue.
And
I think,
their own culture,
to not,
right.
To not hang.
Exactly.
Listen, I have to take this other call. I have to take this other call, eh?
Just maybe ask a question, man. I wrote.
All right, ask your question.
Can we have a separation of powers. Can the legislature amend a law to kind of neutralize the action of the judiciary?
No, it can't do that.
Exactly.
So that is going to be struck down as being unconstitutional
exactly.
and so forth and so on.
All right, sir. Thank you. You answer me good this morning.
Okay.
Because you get to your word.
Well, good.
Morning, Carlo. You have 45 seconds. I'm so sorry.
Hello.
Greetings.
Yeah, man.
Yes, man.
I'm asking you, Miss House of Parliament, to grant me a favor. Check the Water Commission people for me. For about a month now, I've been calling them, telling them about a burst pipe out by nearby 75 Old Harbour Road in our gully, and the water being wasting millions of gallons of water for the past 2 months now, and nobody responds. And I even called the Water Commission, and they said they would send somebody there. Up to last night, nobody come and do anything about it. Please.
Who is your MP? All right, I'm going to ask all right.
Who is your MP? Is, if you're on Old Harbour Road...
Just listen to us when we come off the radio, right? When, because the time gone, eh?
All okay, right. Thanks a lot.
You're welcome. All right, listeners, that's all we have to that caller a while ago. Get in touch with the MP, get in touch with the council. Get them on board with the lobby pressure. Councillor MP on
council,
board.
Council 9843111123. That's the St. Catherine Parish Council.
Look in the directory.
Call them and find out who is the local rep, who is the MP, and then take it from there since NWC not responding.
All right.
Well,
listeners,
that's it
all
for
we
our
have.
Program this morning. Thanks so much to our production staff and also to our techie this morning, Kevin Wallen. Join us tomorrow for a fresh start in...
Fresh start.
Trelawney.
Oh, yes.
Oh, boy.